Allah is my heart's speech. Your mercy is what I beseech. Keep in my heart your remembrance, and in your deen allow me to advance. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test. Help me in my quest, permit me to pass the ultimate test.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على نبيه ومصطفاه سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. I praise Allah the Almighty alone, and I send the best peace and blessings upon his most beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Brothers and sisters, welcome to another live edition of your program Ask Huda. Our phone numbers in the beginning with the area code 002-0125-008-679-78, the other number is area code 002-0100-246-4583, and my Facebook page is the R. Muhammad Salah. Official email addresses are ask@huda.tv and gardens@huda.tv. Brothers and sisters, while waiting for your valuable calls and concerns, we have, mashallah, a long list of pending email questions that I received on my page. Sister Nazia Khan. Sister Nazia Khan says in her question, I met with a brother for marriage purposes, and alhamdulillah, everything went well, except for one thing, that he pays his dad's mortgage. So he would borrow money off other people, and with the money, he would pay the interest part of the mortgage. Then he pays them back. Okay. Well, if he is not the person who is dealing with the mortgage or interest personally and believes that is okay, then there is no problem. If he's assisting his father, he's helping his father, it doesn't mean that he should not continuously advise his father to settle this debt in a way or another. Even if the person has to hand over the house to the bank to get rid of the mortgage. Because we said, and I will say now, and will continue to say until we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hopefully safely, that it is not worth it. The whole life and what it contains is not worth it when it comes to disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when it comes to a command that Allah the Almighty has stated, and it is very obvious, very clear, and you cannot misinterpret it. O you who believe, fear Allah and abandon usury and interest. If you truly believe, if you don't, then Allah declares war against you. Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we're done talking about using the mortgage system to pay for your house or to purchase a house, and we agreed this is not permissible. It is not permissible to take a loan which is interest-based, nor is it allowed to deposit your money in a bank and collect an interest and benefit out of that. كُلُّ خَرْدٍ جَرَّ نَفْعًا فَهُوَ رَبَى, as we stated before. The situation here is not exactly the same, because the person who's proposing to you, he said that you met with him, hopefully in the presence of your mahram or family members or your guardian, because this is very important as well, I would take it as this. Then you figured out that the guy is religiously committed, he's a good suitor and everything, but he's helping his father. I'm glad you recognize that he's helping his father. It is his duty to help his father, but it is also his duty to remind his father that this is not the right way to do it. I would rather live in a rental property, in a flat, in one bedroom flat, rather than living from halal. Rather than living in a big house and having to pay mortgage from haram. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Ummu Muhammad from the KSA. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam,
Go ahead, Sister Ummu Muhammad, please.
Yeah, just Friday before Fajr, my brother passed away. Please pray for him.
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. May Allah have mercy on his soul. May Allah have mercy on his soul, and may Allah have mercy on every dead Muslim who died in a state of Islam. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu attaqullaha haqqa tuqatihi wa la tamutunna illa wa antum muslimun. All who believe, keep your duty to Allah as it should be, and make sure that We should not die, but as Muslims. We should not die as Muslims. But as Muslims. Look, alhamdulillah, shukrullah, when a Muslim person dies, his sister is concerned about him, his parents, if he left living parents, his children, his loved ones. And this is really the virtue, one of the greatest virtues of being a Muslim, that you have people to pray for you after your death. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam counted this dua, which the person would earn after his death, one of the avenues which will continue to provide him with good deeds. أَوَلَدٍ صَالِحٍ يَدْعُوا لَهُ. So we should include our parents, our brothers and sisters, those who died from amongst our family members in our dua, because this dua is guaranteed to benefit them while in their graves. Ibrahim alayhi salam taught us, and Allah recounted what he said in the Quran, saying, رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الْحِسَابِ. It's a very beautiful supplication. O Allah, my Lord, forgive me my sins, forgive my parents and all the believers, men and women, when the accounting day is established. Allahumma ameen. Arbaz Khan says in his question, what is the ruling on doing push-ups? While doing push-ups, the person goes up and goes down. And while he's down, his forehead is against the ground. So he's comparing this to an act of bowing down. And he's trying to say that it should not be permissible. Rather, he said, is it permissible or not? Is putting the head on the ground and kissing the floor considered shirk? Look, this is not an act of worship. It is not even a form of greeting of somebody. You're doing push-ups. That's an exercise. Similarly, bowing down to do your exercise, no problem whatsoever. If you were saying that bowing down to somebody as even as a way of greeting him or her, that is not permissible. Because the Prophet ﷺ said that we should not bow down but before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jara from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum. Go ahead.
What is the ruling on posting
image,
human image, in room
where
you pray?
Sister Jara, I didn't get it. I'm sorry.
Can you hear me, sir?
Now I hear you. Go ahead, please. طيب. Try again, Sister Jara, please. Barakallahu fiki. No problem. Assalamu alaikum. Brother Hamid from the KSA. Brother Hamid, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking. How about yourself?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. For the last 10 days, I was giving this some small articles on death on Facebook.
Now,
and yesterday morning, I heard that my closest friend, who had gone on vacation to his country, he died in an accident.
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. May Allah have mercy on him.
He was so close to me, and he was so such a nice and generous fellow, a very excellent fellow. So I just wanted to pray for him. He has 3 small daughters and a son who is just maybe 8 or 9 years old.
Subhanallah. What is his name, brother?
His name is Tariq Mir.
Can you say that again?
Tariq Ahmed Mir.
Brother Tariq Ahmed. May Allah have mercy
on
him.
Yeah, he was very young, very, very, in a young, very age, he died. And I was just like his father, he was just like my son. But I treated him as my son. And a mentor in learning Arabic and other things. So he was just like my teacher, although he was just like my son.
May Allah have mercy on his soul. May Allah make his grave a garden of paradise, forgive him his sins, and double his good deeds.
Ameen.
May Allah protect his children, the orphans, and his wife, and provide for them. Allahumma ameen. Every moment we see and we hear somebody died. And this is a very sound alarm to me, to you, to to everybody else, particularly to the oppressors, and hopefully to the rulers who are neglecting their duties towards Allah and towards their community. Your palaces, your Lamborghinis, your bulletproof cars, fortified houses will not avail you an aught, will not protect you against death, and none would support you once you die, none would stand next to you but your deeds. So it's either you build up an asset of good deeds or otherwise. And as far as your remark, Brother Hamid, when you said he died very young, it just made me remember what Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, may Allah have mercy on him, used to say when he phrased this beautiful poem, when he said, تَزَوَّدْ مِنَ التَّقْوَى فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي إِذَا جَنَّ لَيْلٌ هَلْ تَعِيشُ إِلَى الْفَجْرِ فَكَمْ مِنْ فَتًى أَمْسَى وَأَصْبَحَ ضَاحِكًا وَقَدْ نُسِجَتْ أَكْفَانُهُ وَهُوَ لَا يَدْرِي وَكَمْ مِنْ عَرُوسٍ زَيَّنُوهَا لِزَوْجِهَا وَقَدْ قُبِضَتْ أَرْوَاحُهُمْ لَيْلَةَ الْقَدْرِ وَكَمْ مِنْ صِغَارٍ يُرْتَجَى طُولَ عُمْرِهِمْ وَقَدْ أُدْخِلَتْ أَجْسَادُهُمْ ظُلْمَةَ الْقَبْرِ وَكَمْ مِنْ صَحِيحٍ مَاتَ مِنْ غَيْرِ عِلَّةٍ وَكَمْ مِنْ سَقِيمٍ عَاشَ حِينًا مِنَ الدَّهْرِ. I wish I can give you the exact meaning of this beautiful poem by Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib. He said, you better seek and take your provision of righteousness before it is too late. We'll continue, inshallah, as we go by while taking some calls. Assalamu alaikum. Jara from Nigeria, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum salam, Sheikh.
Go ahead.
I have two questions.
Now.
Firstly, can I pray in a room where human image are posted?
Can you pray in a room where there is a picture of a human being, right?
Yes.
Okay. Your second question, please. Now.
What is the ruling on picking cartoons or cartoon images on computers, phones, and even in a room where you can do ibadah?
Tayyib, barakallahu fik. First of all, we're not allowed to hang any images of live, living beings, human beings, animals, birds, against the walls. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had a curtain which he was praying and he noticed while praying, which had an image of a bird. So this is very, very typical situation to what we have at home in the curtains, on the walls, in the frames. And after the prayer, he ordered Aisha to tear it apart and he made it into a cushion or cushions or spread. So we're not allowed to keep that against the wall. But pictures and images of nature, trees and rivers and mountains, all of that is permissible. When you pray also, you should not have anything facing you, such as a picture, a statue, or anything. If a person is walking in somebody's house and does not have a choice, then find an angle or a way that you face the Qibla and that is not in your direction. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Nadia from the KSA. Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sheikh, I have called you last week about regarding face covering, and I told you that I have started it on Eid day, and now it's like today's 14th show, also like 14 days that I've gone. But I mentioned you about my husband's opinion, and you explained me both things. My question is right now that because he's still having that opinion, that I should not cover the face in front of the family members. And you mentioned even that it is the same like outside. But because there is both opinions, I just want to ask you that I have to follow the opinion what I prefer, like this one, that is better to cover the face, or I have to obey my husband. Because now I'm confused that is this more same if I will not obey my husband, because in this case especially there is the ikhtilaf. And because I am listening to you for 3 years, and I always do whatever you are telling because I trust you so much. So whatever I listen from you, I at once follow that. But because there is a khilaf in this case, so I am still so much confused. He said that I'm not happy from you. And he is not a cruel man. He's a very nice person. I'm trying to convince him But still, I just want to, regarding for the time being, I want to ask you that what should I do? What is preferable for me? To follow his opinion or to follow the opinion which I like most, because you told me that that is better, the best one. Thank you,
Sheikh. You're most welcome. Barakallahu fiki. That's very nice of you. And I'm very glad that there are a couple like you, and you're really praising and admiring your husband in public. So I hope, inshallah, he would also enjoy that and benefit of the following advice. I found an ayah in the Quran which says, وَلَا تُبَطِلُوا أَعْمَالَكُمْ. Do not ruin your deeds. If you started a good thing, resume it, continue it, and do not ruin it. So that is my advice. Even if you adopted it as mustahab, recommended in the beginning, why would you abandon it? And for what? Alhamdulillah wa shukla. And this is something that is good for you as a husband, for the brother who may be watching me right now, or every husband. Somebody, his wife would like to keep her beauty, including her face, only for him. That's something every man likes, you know. Even if you consult non-Muslims, you would say, I like that. So I would say, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, ati'u Allah wa ati'u rasula wa la tubatilu a'malakum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Ummu Ahmad from United Arab Emirates.
Wa alaikum assalam, Sheikh.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm having a problem of white discharge. It's not urine, actually. Every often, so is it, and I have treated it many times, and it is not getting cure. Is it okay for me to pray for, I don't have to take, is it that I have to take wudu for each prayer, or okay that I can pray once I take wudu and I can pray for?
طيب, barakallahu fiki, thank you, Muhammad. Continue this, the meaning of the beautiful poem that I discussed with you about Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib, when he advised that one should take advantage of his life before he's surprised with death. Surprised, this is most of the living beings. Let's talk about the human beings for now. Most of the human beings are being surprised with death, and they did not expect that they would die that soon. Why did I say most? Obviously, no human being, no one is told when he or she will die. Even when doctors estimate that a few days, a few weeks, the person may live way beyond that. And we have seen repeatedly many cases like that. But I'm talking about that the angel of death would not give you a warning. But there are some cases when the person is at a very senile age, or with a terminal ailment. So these are all alarms, very sound alarms. But Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali, may Allah be pleased with him, said, فَإِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي, since you have no idea. إِذَا جَنَّ لَيْلٌ هَلْ تَعِيشُ إِلَى الْفَجْرِ, when the night falls, would you really make it to the morning? Would you live until the morning or not? Allah يتوفى الأنفس حين موتها. Whenever we go to sleep, Allah takes the souls. And whomever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to survive, to live, He would instill the soul back to him so he would come back to life. And now, موتة صغرى. When we go to sleep, this is a semi-death, a mini-death. Then, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns this person not to get up again, the soul will be preserved with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he will die. يَتَوَفَّ الْأَنفُسَ حِينَ مَوْتِهَا. Then he says, Amir al-Mu'mineen radiyallahu anhu, فَكَمْ مِنْ فَتَنْ أَمْسَى وَأَصْبَحَ ضَاحِكًا. Now he is speaking about young kids, youth, teenagers, whom parents and everybody imagines that they have a long way to go. An athlete is playing around in the playground, is very active. How many people have we seen in the soccer game? They dropped dead. Many. Without any introduction, without any warning. They're very young. They're very healthy. They're athletic. How many athletes died without any previous warning. It happens all the time. فَكَمْ مِنْ فَتَنْ أَمْسَى وَأَصْبَحَ ضَحِكًا, laughing, having fun, because he have a bright future to go. وَقَدْ نُسِجَتْ أَكْفَانُهُ وَهُوَ لَا يَدْرِي, while his shroud has been prepared for him, while he has no idea. He did not perceive that, that's it, that is the last day. Well, if this is the case, then prepare for the journey by seeking the proper provision before it is too late. تزود من التقوى فإنك لا تدري إذا جن ليل هل تعيش إلى الفجر. السلام عليكم. Sister Umm Safiya from United Arab Emirates.
Walaikum Assalam, Sheikh.
Assalamu Alaikum, Sister Umm Safiya. Welcome to
Sir, I would like to appreciate the fantastic topic that you're discussing today. And it is really shaking us and bringing us back to reality with all the glorious things in this world.
Naam.
Sir, I have two questions, if I may. One is that, just wanted to clarify that are we supposed to observe hijab and cover ourselves in the same way that we do for salat, and that we have to do it while reading and reciting the Quran, and besides observing wudu? And also, if somebody is ill, and can they just lie down and read the Quran if they are not able to sit and read it? And the second question is, somebody told me that if you are not well and you're seeking help from Allah, and then you have to read the Quran and complete it in 3 days. So that will bring you shifa, inshallah, by the will of God. And is it true, and can we do this and try this? And what is your ruling on this? I just wanted your opinion. Thank you so much. Jazakallah khair.
Wa jazakum barakallahu fik, Sister Umm Safiya from United Arab Emirates. Thank you, and may Allah give you shifa. Assalamu alaikum. Next, Sister Rahina from Nigeria.
Yes.
Assalamu alaikum.
Yes, yes. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum
assalam. Well, I better not talk. Go ahead, Sister Rahina.
I have six fasting to repair from my the fasting that I missed from my period. I heard that if I make one intention for retain for my missed fasting, that is for 6 days, and then I make the same intention for Sister Shawwal, then I can just fast six, and that is all.
Okay. Thank you, Sister Rahina. I got your question, and what you heard is not true. Buy one, get one free does not apply here, because this is fard, this is not obligatory fasting, and this is voluntary one. You cannot overlap and combine the two intentions in one. So the ideal way is to fast and make up the 6 missed days first, then follow that by fasting the 6 days of Shawwal. I said the ideal, because sometimes it becomes permissible to begin with the 6 days of Shawwal, especially when the woman has plenty of days, 13 days for instance. 13 days to make up, and another 6 days to fast, that is total, mashallah, 19 days. And also during this month of Shawwal, she may experience a period, so it will be impossible to do it, right? So in this case, if she began with the 6 days of Shawwal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may accept from her with the same intention. But making up the missed days should be a separate intention than any other nafl. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Umm Ahmad from the KSA.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi.
I'm sorry, what did you just say? Sister Umm Ahmad.
Yeah,
you can perform Umrah in Mantab Shawwal. You can perform Umrah any day, day or night, any time, any date, no problem whatsoever. It is okay to perform Umrah during the month of Shawwal. Not only that, it is permissible. We read in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ تَمَتَّعَ بِالْعُمْرَةِ إِلَى الْحَجِّ فَمَا اسْتَيْسَرَ مِنَ الْهَدِي. he who enjoys making Umrah, then does tahallul, then does Hajj in the same year, then he is required to offer the Hajj. When to perform Umrah to Tamattu' throughout the whole month of Shawwal, and the first 9 days, eight days, or even in the ninth in the morning. But you wouldn't do Tamattu', of course, 8 days of the month of, and the whole month of Dhul Qa'dah, and the first 8 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah. Barakallah feekum. We'll take a short break, and we have Ummu Ahmad and Ummu Safiya to answer the question soon after the break, inshallah.
Let's start from where they started. Who are they? The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When they started learning the religion of Islam, they started with the aqidah, the belief system, faith. Brothers and sisters in Islam, dear viewers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spent 13 years in Mecca teaching that generation the belief system, the aqidah. Aisha radiallahu anha confirms this by saying, the first things which were revealed from the Quran was matters of aqidah. Who is Allah? Jannah, paradise and hell. Jundub ibn Abdullah al-Bajali, may Allah be pleased with him, said, we learned the belief system, we learned al-Iman, we learned the aqidah, then we learn the Quran, then we learn the Quran. Brothers and sisters in Islam, nowadays, a lot of our cultural practices, a lot of our societal norms are against our belief system. And the reason why we're falling into this, because we did not start from where they started. Join me, Kareem Abu Zaid, twice a week on Huda TV screen with the new edition, Aqeedah Matters. See you then.
Imagine that the Anbiya, they were the ones that were the most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they had the hardest task.
He assumed that he had some kind of superiority and he was a better, more chosen, you know, a select, better person because he had this wealth. And then you look at all the other people who had wealth, and some of them were the worst people. You had Fir'aun and
reviving your niyyah time and again, that you're doing insincerely.
Most of the youth, they think, oh, I'm going to pray when I'm old, it's okay, now I'll have fun with my life. Later on I'll work, I'll grow my beard, I'll pray 5 times a day. And all these things, they think that that's later on in their life, and they don't know when they will die.
Amira, who's your role model?
Khadija radiallahu anha.
And why?
Because she was Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's wife, and she was the first lady to believe in Islam.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back, and we already have Sister Aisha on the line from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum, Sister Aisha.
Wa alaikum assalam, my brother. My name is Aisha, I'm calling from Dubai. I have two questions to start with briefly. One is I am working in an insurance broking company, wherein the income of my company is a commission, which is getting from insurance companies, basically. Now, I am a revert Muslim working since last 6 years, but never this question prompted me so eagerly like during this Ramadan. And since that time, I'm so worried as to, is my income to the right? So that, am I doing something which will please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? And whatever I'm reading and all, it's a little mixed up. Somebody says it's not direct, so it's okay. I am a little confused on that aspect. That is one thing. Second is, I have heard and I believe that without Allah's, you know, we say nothing happens without Allah's will. And we also know that our sole purpose of creation is to worship Allah. Now, my parents are not Muslim. I have a brother. So I feel for them. I do pray that may Allah give them hidayat, you know, so that they can understand Islam. But the whole question I keep on thinking is, if Allah wants them to be a Muslim, why don't that thought come in their mind like it came to me, that they should be thinking about it? And if they don't come to Islam, maybe they will die as an unbeliever. So, I mean, I know I can pray, but I cannot understand this concept. Why? Because my family say that we are born as a Muslim, we will die, or we are born as a Hindu, or we will die as a Hindu only. You know, these kind of things. So how will they come? I'm doing my best to convey to them. I don't understand certain aspects of this. Why some people are born as a Muslim, and then they think they are right because they were born there, and God only made them, you know, take birth in that particular family, in that particular religion. A little confused on that.
Sister Aisha, Jazakallah khairan. Now with regards to your first question, you said you work in an insurance company, right?
Yes.
Okay, what is the nature of your job, Sister Aisha, please? Is it a commercial insurance company?
Yeah, all the insurance companies that we are dealing are conventional. I cannot say they are Sharia compliant.
And your company is an insurance company, right?
No, we are not insurance companies, brother. We arrange insurances for our clients through insurance companies.
Okay,
and we
earn
commission.
Yeah, okay, Sister Aisha, barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Sister Zainab from Uganda.
Alaikum salam.
Assalamu alaikum, Sister Zainab, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you. How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking. Go ahead, Sister Zainab, please.
I was asking if about whether you see a dead body.
Can you say that again, please, Sister Zainab?
When you see a dead body, are you supposed to perform qutl?
I'm sorry, I didn't get it, Sister Zainab. You said a dead body. Do what about it?
When you see a dead body, are you supposed to perform qutl?
I'm sorry, I didn't get the question.
That is it.
Okay, I figured that you said when you see a dead body, you're supposed to do what? I don't understand. Try again, or you can leave your question with the control, inshallah. Okay. Brother Muhammad from the KSA, assalamu alaikum. Alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
I have got one question.
Now,
after sunnah prayers, after the first sunnah and nafil, I used to pray two rakat. Shall we, I have to make a gap between each unit, or shall I, after the finishing one, another one I have to start?
Okay.
Because somewhere I have read, I remember that do not make the chain of the salah, like some hadith is there. Yeah.
Now, what you're talking about, Brother Muhammad, is concerning joining the nafl immediately after the fard. That is not permissible. Okay? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade so, that the person, after finishing the fard namaz, they get up right away to pray the sunnah. You're supposed to leave a gap of talking, of moving, of changing their place, in order to announce that the following prayer is nafl, not a fard. This is like one of the ahkam of blocking the means of confusing the issues, sunnah and nafl. But now if you're praying nafl prayer, two by two for instance, it's not necessary to leave gap. Okay, barakallah feek. Now I would like to go to Sister Umm Ahmed's question from United Arab Emirates with regards to the clear or the wide discharge, the vaginal secretions or excretions or discharge. That requires wudu for each prayer. Obviously, if the person who's been afflicted with this condition is by analogy similar to urine incontinence, we always advise that you should wear a pad in your underclothes in order to replace it easily without having to wash your undergarment on a regular basis. And once you hear the adhan, you can perform wudu and pray in this condition even if there is a flow of this discharge. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us to observe our ibadat on time and properly. Sister Umm Safiya from United Arab Emirates had a couple of questions. The first is it required to wear hijab while reading the Quran? No, it is not required. If some sister, if some person likes to dress up the best outfit that they have and wear the nice perfume and sit facing the Qibla to recite Quran, that's perfectly fine. These are all adab, but is it required for a woman to wear hijab the same way that she wears in the salah in order to recite Quran? No, it is not required. Similarly, I don't know how could a person say such thing that is it required for a woman to wear hijab while performing wudu? How do you wear hijab while performing wudu? I don't get it. Well, unfortunately, there are some people who circulate that. If you are at the privacy of your house before your husband and children, how do you wear long sleeves and wear the khimar and the hijab and if you're following the vast majority, you wear socks to cover your feet too. How would you perform wudu while you're covered fully? So wudu does not, neither wudu nor ghusl. You didn't have to wear hijab. Wearing hijab is only if you are before non-mahram or if you're offering the prayer. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Brother Muhammad from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum, Muhammad.
Wa alaikum salam. Yeah, how are you?
I'm just fine, alhamdulillah. Thank you for asking.
Yeah, I have one question.
Now,
that I've seen in Masjid al-Haram that during the Zuhar Salah, the Imam stands behind and the people stand in front of him. So is the Salah valid?
طيب بارك الله فيك. Actually, they don't stand exactly behind him. Rather, they arrange it in such way that between the Imam and the Kaaba, there is none. And that's why the security guard put lines or some soldiers in order to keep people away from the distance between the Imam and the Kaaba. Then on both sides, because this is round the Kaaba, in both sides, if they happen to be ahead of the Imam, it's okay. What really matters is behind the Imam, not on both sides. So when we surround the Kaaba and the road that is facing the Imam happens to be nearer to the Kaaba, then the Imam, that is okay. Okay. Sister Umm Safiya's third question, that somebody told her that in order to get shifa, to get cured from your sickness, you should recite the Quran fully in 3 days. What was mentioned with regards to reciting the Quran fully in 3 days or making khatm al-Quran in 3 days is when the Prophet ﷺ advised Abdullah ibn Umar ibn Khattab, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, particularly Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As in this regard, when he knew that he fasts on every single day and he reads the Quran every single, he prays every single night and he may finish the Quran every day or every 2 days. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam advised that the Quran should not be recited in less than 3 days because you cannot comprehend it. You would not understand what you're reciting. 3 days, that means 10 paras every day. And by the way, it is doable. reciting 10 paras every day is doable, especially in a time like Ramadan, or if you happen to be in i'tikaf in the haram. The whole environment is encouraging. But is it prescribed to recite the whole Quran in 3 days in order to be cured? I don't have any reference to that. Rather, the reference we have is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. The whole Quran is cure and mercy for the believers. And during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he has used the Quran and his companions have utilized the Quran as means of ruqya for cure, and as cure from many psychological, physical, and pathological diseases. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Roseman from United Arab Emirates. Assalamu alaikum, sister.
Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Do me a favor and mute your TV set, please.
Yeah, this is Roseman. I'm calling from Dubai.
Nah. Go ahead, welcome to Ask Huda.
Alhamdulillah, I'm so happy to talk with you. I have questions which I wanted to ask for so many years, and no one is giving me the answer.
I hope I will be able to do that. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was married, and I was stayed with my husband for 14 years. Mm-hmm. I got married at the age of 17 and divorced at the age of 32 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I am the one who asked for the divorce.
Okay.
And because I didn't have choice, I had to come out of there because it reached a time which I was thinking to commit suicide. Or I was feeling like I'll go crazy because there is so many bad things which it was happening to me.
Okay. So what is the question, sister?
The question is like, I was very angry when I came out of there, and I didn't stay for my either 3 months after the divorce.
What do you mean you didn't stay for that? Did you get married?
I was married. I'm divorced. After the divorce, I'm supposed to stay for either.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't stay for the either.
What do you mean?
So what can I do?
You said you didn't stay. You didn't stay with him at home, or what do you mean?
I was not with him at home because I'm from Kenya, so I had to go back to my parents.
No.
And he took my kids. I had to leave my kids because my situation was not good, and I was very confused.
Mm. Okay.
Because he married another woman.
Okay. So
then
now
he was torturing me.
Okay, now the situation that he did not allow you to stay in, am I right?
Yeah.
Well, if he did not allow you to stay at home with him, or he did not provide you with housing during the iddah, then you're not blameworthy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah At-Talaq, لا تخرجوهن من بيوتهن ولا يخرجن إلا أن يأتين بفاحشة مبينة. It is not permissible to force a wife whom you divorced to leave home during the iddah, which is وَالْمُطَلَّقَاتُ يَتَرَبَّصْنَ بِأَنفُسِهِنَّ ثَلَاثَةَ قُرُوءٍ. If a woman still experiences the period, you have 3 periods, and you enjoy staying at home and you enjoy the full support whether you have kids or not. But if he did not allow you, if he forced you out, then you're not blameworthy. What if a woman did not stay home willingly? She chose not to stay at home, even though the husband was very kind and he said, you may stay if you want to. She chose not to stay. She's blameworthy. How long ago was that? That was a long time ago. What you need to do is to repent and seek forgiveness. And Allah is the of forgiving, the most merciful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from you your repentance and from all of us. Barakallahu feekum. Sister, I'm trying to. Sister Aisha from United Arab Emirates, who works for a company that regulates and organizes providing insurance for Asians and clients, this job is not permissible. This job is not permissible because the commercial insurance is not permissible. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَلَا تَعَاوَنُوا عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. We should not be a part of nor assist in doing any transgression or any sins. So what should you do? What should you do is start looking for another job and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala meanwhile to provide you with another job which will provide you with a halal income. We gotta make an effort. It isn't sufficient to say, I wish, I desire, I would like to, I hope. No, make an effort. لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. So now, if you don't have any other source of income, you don't have the means to support yourself while looking for another job, the scholar said you can keep the job while working hard, applying for other jobs if you have to work, if you have to support yourself or others. Okay? But working for a conventional bank, a commercial insurance company, providing commercial insurance is not permissible in Islam. As far as your parents who are not Muslims yet and your brother, you said that, why doesn't Allah give them hidayah and hasten their hidayah? Well, this is a very interesting question. Because remember, when did you accept Islam? You said recently. Why didn't you accept Islam before? It happens only when Allah allows that to happen. In Surah Al-An'am, Allah the Almighty says, فَمَنْ يُرِدِ اللَّهُ أَنْ يَهْدِيَهُ يَشْرَحْ صَدَرَهُ لِلْإِسْلَامِ. Whomsoever Allah wills to guide, he will open his heart to accept Islam. It may happen for a reason or even without any reason. Simply because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided it's time for this person to become rightly guided. You find this person being approached, preached, advice day and night, and no. His heart is locked. His hearing, his sight is like he's not functioning. While another person is taking a journey, going to Las Vegas, planning on having fun and, you know, sleeping with different women, playing, gambling and drinking and all of that. And he sits next to a person, he sees him opening the Quran. What is this? He starts a conversation over a couple hours, he likes his deen, and he changes the course. He changes the course because it's time. So we don't know when this time will come. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah said to him in Surah Al-Qasas, إِنَّكَ لَتَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتُ. We love our parents. I met, I think it was last Hajj, a sister who's been married to a Muslim for 30 years. Over 30 years, she was still Christians. All the kids are Muslims and practicing, and the husband. But only after 30 years, she truly decided to accept Islam. And before that, she was so stubborn. No one could convince her to abandon whatever she was following and believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, if the key is with Allah, then let's all ask Him, Ya Allah, ihdina as-sirat al-mustaqim. Guide us and our loved ones, our parents, our children, our loved ones, guide all of us to the straight path. Continuously ask Allah for hidayah for your parents and your brother. And as alhamdulillah, you're fulfilling your duty towards them, giving them da'wah and talking to them, and you crown that with the greatest mean of hidayah, which is dua or praying for them. May Allah make it happen and very soon. Allahumma ameen. We actually came to the end of today's edition of Ask Huda. Until next episode, I leave you in the care of Allah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
Allah is my heart's speech, Your mercy is what I beseech.